it's a story about Queen Anne, her favourite, Sarah Churchill, and another woman played by Emma Stone, who is brought in and sort of takes over. So it's a power struggle, really, between these three women. And I play the Duke of Marlborough, who is Sarah Churchill's husband, and it's directed by Yorgos Lanthimos. And yeah, I think it's going to be great. It was a really interesting process. We shot it in natural light. It's very big kind of costume drama, but essentially boils down to the power play between these three women, Emma Stone, Rachel Weisz, and Olivia Colman. So yes, I'm very much looking forward to seeing it. Also, this is a little actor's thing. When you're going for a costume fitting, I had one the other day, and it was for a World War II suit, and it was getting so worn, you know, because it's the real thing. So what everyone's always praying for is a big new war film so they can get costumes made. And Queen Anne is a period that's very rarely done. So the fact that the favourite had all these costumes made means that they'll last for about a century now. You know, talent will out. Rachel has an amazing kind of grace and delicacy, I think. She's just amazing to watch. When you see her on screen, she's just translucently beautiful, but incredibly, incredibly talented. And Emma Stone I'd never met. We had our read-through the day after she won the Oscar, and it was just fantastic. She had a kind of ready-break glow around her of excitement, but she was incredibly down-to-earth, very, very lovely, and not in any way starry. It was just great fun.
There's so much excitement about your new imagining of Dracula, which we're waiting for. I guess for you, what is the timeless magic of that story, and what are you most hoping to explore with your version?
Well, it's like Sherlock Holmes, you see. It's Dracula is one of the most photographed filmed characters in fiction because it's such a great idea. You know, vampires have been with us for a long time, but what Stoker did was make him into this amazing kind of slightly Byronic, rather tragic figure, I think. You know, so the reason it's still read and is made so often is simply because it's so good. And we want to, as with Sherlock, we want to keep all the good bits from all the films and all the vampire legends and everything, and just kind of reinvent it for now, if it is set now. Christopher Robin, thank you very much. Yeah, I don't know when that's out. That was a delightful experience. Big, big Disney movie. Mm-hmm. Ewan McGregor, toys. Mm-hmm. Hayley Atwell, more toys. Yeah. It was lovely. Yeah, and I sort of play the baddie, although I'm really more of an idiot. But yes.
Did you watch Winnie the Pooh when you were growing up?
I love Winnie the Pooh. Yeah. What I find very interesting about the Disney Winnie the Pooh is that it doesn't seem to matter that he has an American voice. It kind of fits, doesn't it? Mm. Don't know why. It shouldn't work, but it does. I always found those films absolutely enchanting. So I hope this will continue the tradition.
Greg and I, who is the president of the Newport Beach Film Festival, and I had lunch at a Mexican restaurant 5 years ago. And the festival has had a long-standing commitment to British cinema. And we said, you know, we need to really step up that and to take our story to London to better highlight exactly what the achievements are of British cinema, because it's now, between streaming as well as television as well as cinema itself, Brits I think really have a unique place, and they actually I think are leaders in entertainment today in so many ways, and that's why we wanted to make sure we could tell that story, because the film festival has always had a commitment to it, and tonight's really endemic of that commitment. And to think we have come, this is our fourth year, and to see where we are now just blows me away. It's extraordinary.
You were just talking, obviously, about Star Trek, and I'm curious, how early on did you know that secret? Was that something you knew when you approached the character right from the get-go, or...?
Yeah, I knew right from the beginning. Because if you watch the thing for a second time, you'll see that I knew, because I give clues away all the time, and because there are moments that come up where he doesn't quite remember something, or where he's behaving in a very un-Starfleet way, which at the beginning a lot of the fans were upset about. Now they realise why we were doing it. So I had to know right from the beginning what the plan was. I just couldn't tell anyone. It was difficult because I've done a lot of press over the last 6 months, and I've lied every single time I've met anybody, including to friends of mine, for which I apologise.
you most proud of the first season run? Because I think, obviously, I know you've spoken a lot about how symbolic that series is in so many different levels.
Well, first of all, it's great to be part of something that is so beloved and not up. You know, at first, all the fans, and it's a huge fan base, who rightly protected this legacy, and now, pretty much mostly, they love us, so that's a great feeling that we didn't blow it. And then also, in these very troubled, divisive times where, you know, the most powerful man in the world is spouting racism all the time, to present a vision of the future which is unified and where people aren't separated or judged by gender or sexuality or race, is it feels like you're part of something that, you know, that needs, stories that need to be told.
Of course, the Mirror Universe arc does leave open the possibility of you returning and playing the original Lorca. Is that something that would interest you, to play a more Starfleet-worthy version of the character?
Well, I'll throw it back on the audience. Would you want to see a paled-down, diluted version of Mirror Lorca, who was very watchable and, you know, charismatic? I think if somebody came up with a great story, then I'd be more than interested, because I love being on board, and I love staying energized, and I love ducking faces. But it would have to be good, because I think what we did this season was really, really watchable.
You've got so many great things coming up. Talking about Glass, first of all, you're working with one of the most unique and distinctive directors in the business. Can you talk about what makes him such a special presence behind the camera and what your experience was like working with him on that?
Knight is one of my favorite people in the entire world, and he is genuinely so meticulous about absolutely everything. There's not a single thing in that film that he hasn't handpicked and really, really thought about. And he's just so intelligent. You know, you get to the end of reading the script and you're like, how did you even come up with this? And he's also a really wonderful person, so that helps.
With Unbreakable and then Split, it was such a unique version of the comic book film that we're now so familiar with. Do you think that's something that is going to be distilled into its final form with Glass?
Absolutely, and I think people are going to be truly blown away. Like, that's another thing that makes Knight so unique. You haven't seen a movie like that really before. So the fact that I get to be a part of it just feels like a dream come true.
Of course, at the same time, you're joining the New Mutants as well. What do you think that's going to add to our already amazing X-Men universe?
Tonal shift, and Josh was really, really into that. And so I think people are going to be excited to see mutants who are incredibly troubled, but also just kids and trying to grow up like that. He wanted it to be like John Hughes with a horror movie, and so I think that tone is just really interesting. It's a trip, definitely. I think people are going to be really surprised, really impressed. Josh is a wonderful director, and the performances that, you know, everyone put in were wonderful. Like, we genuinely felt like we were living the same experience, because we were all just put into a hotel, obviously without any animosity. Like, we had a good time, but we were all put into this hotel and we're just getting to know each other much the same way that these kids were. So I wasn't actually aware of Ileana, though, and the second that I got the job, I went to a comic book store, bought all the comics, and was just like, yes.
Thomas, it's amazing to have you here tonight. Obviously, fans are so excited to have just got our last installment of the Maze Runner saga. I'm curious how you feel looking back at that film now and the amazing journey you've had with that wonderful cast and director.
I mean, it's been a process that's been going on for the last 5 years, and I've met some wonderful people and traveled around the world and got to act with some really very talented young people and a first-time director, and get to watch him grow. And the whole experience has been a wonderful one. I have friends from that I'll have for the rest of my life. And I'm so happy that, as an audience, the fact that it had an audience and that it was appreciated and accepted and enjoyed by so many people.
Why do you think it is a story that resonates so much with such a wide global audience? Because I think it's action-packed, but there's a lot of, I think, important subtext to this saga.
Ladies, yeah, there is. And gentlemen, I mean, it's
welcome to the 2018, you know, UK Honours, presented by Visit Newport Beach and the Newport Beach Film Festival.
I'll just go.
How does it feel to be so honoured tonight, an artist of distinction?
I think it's the most marvellous thing I've ever heard of. I mean, I've only just heard about it, but what a marvellous thing to say that you are. I couldn't be more delighted, actually. And especially because it's got such an American exchange. So to get the thumbs up from America, I consider even more of a thrill, actually. Well, I've got Finding Your Feet coming out any minute. which is rather thrilling. And then I've got a new book coming out the day before called Sail Away. And then I'm going back to LA to do season 3 of Better Things, which I love. And then you can be very frightened because I'm in my first horror film called Malevolent, and I am not at all nice.
What can fans expect from season 3 of Better Things?
A bigger part for me, I hope, but I'm just being greedy, but I absolutely love it. So I'm really looking forward to that.
Obviously, the book as well is something that fans are very excited about. Can you tell us just a little bit about what you're hoping they get from that?
Well, peculiarly, the book has two female protagonists, two heroines, a bit like Finding Your Feet. It's quite unusual, in a way, for a film or a book to have two female leads of my age. And so I'm rather excited that I've managed to pull that off, because you obviously have to write about what you know. So my characters are about my age. And it's all set on a huge, great ship across the Atlantic Ocean. And the two women don't know each other at all, but by fluke they find themselves on the same boat. And then they have one person in common. They don't know that, but one person links them, and he is a murderer. So it's all rather exciting, because no one can get off. So the whole thing has to be solved by the time the ship docks.
We absolutely adore Alias Grace, and I know that's a series that's meant an awful lot to a lot of people. Can you talk a little bit about what most spoke to you about that story and the experience of working with a lot of fantastic women in front and behind the camera on that one?
Well, the women in it were phenomenal. I mean, the whole team were women. The director, the producers, obviously Sarah, the writer, Sarah Polly. So it was actually quite daunting when I arrived, because, you know, I've done things like Kingsman, which are all men. So it was a total opposite, and it couldn't have been a better experience. It was amazing. It was lovely. They're incredibly intelligent, incredibly powerful women, and very inspiring. And the project was... Look, like you said, it speaks to a lot of people. It's very current. It's very relevant at the moment. I tend personally not to pick projects on the political issues. Like, for me, it's about the character. It's about the story. And I was moved by it. I was moved by the story. Yeah. So much of it is subjective. These things are very subjective. And what one person thinks of it is very different to another person. I tried not to say what I think about it or what the challenges were, because that's not really my area. I mean, it was challenging, but when we were filming it, we didn't think about like the relevance it has in the outside world. You were just focusing on the relationships and trying to make it real. And the bigger picture, that's in the director's hands. That's not my job.
There's so much discussion going on at the moment about Me Too and Time's Up. And I'm curious, I mean, as a man in the industry, how you feel you fit into that process? You know, how can you be part of the solution? How can you be part of the discussion?
I think it's everyone's job to speak up. Someone asked me this the other day, and like, for me, I'm a white male, middle class. I'm privileged. I have never had to have these problems before, so it's very hard for me to like. I can only try and understand what it's like to be a woman in this industry, but in life in general. So I would, there's only so much you can say without, I think you have to do your part. You have to say if you see something. I'm hoping that enough is now happening to make something change. Clearly there needs to be a change. And I hope there is, and I'd be behind whatever needs to be done to make that change, because it can't go on, you know.
Honour to have you here for us tonight. We're so excited by the astonishing response that Black Panther's been getting. What does it mean for you to not only be part of a great film, but one that is being hailed by so many people as a watershed moment, especially for the genre?
I think it's very well deserved for Ryan Coogler. I mean, he is such an honest filmmaker. He's a brilliant director, and he has created something from the heart, really. It was the movie that he's always wanted to see, and when that touches you know, it's such a huge part of the world in the way that it has done. That's as a filmmaker, I'm very, very proud for him. And as for being part of it, yeah, couldn't be better. I mean, I think it's a really smart piece of filmmaking, and tells a great story. And like you say, it is a watershed movie. Hopefully, there's never been a predominantly black cast in such a big tentpole movie, superhero movie, and it's ridiculous to think that we have to make a fuss about it because it should be like this all the time, but we do have to make a celebration of it because it is the first time. It's a phenomenal ensemble, and you know, Ryan Coogler wrote a brilliant movie. It's played across the board with great skill and dedication and fun. Actually, there's a lot of wit and humour in the piece, and you know, it's smart actors, all smart actors involved who know exactly what they're doing, and you know, and Ryan created this incredible atmosphere to work on it. So yeah, it was great.
Of course, with Last Jedi, there was a mixed reaction from fans because of some of the creative choices, and I think the demise or the seeming demise of Snoke so early in the character's introduction is one of those big decisions. How did you feel about that as a storyteller yourself and as the person responsible for it?
I mean, Rian Johnson's choice is, I think is absolutely right for the story that he wanted to tell, and I was the way it happened and the storytelling and the big sort of central scene where there is that confrontation, I think was a great piece of filmmaking. So I'm happy with that. Obviously, yeah, you know, Snoke, it's a Star Wars movie. What can I say? Anything can happen.
I mean, obviously, with Snoke, I think fans were so desperate to get some sense of his backstory and the wider context for his presence in the saga. Is that something that, whether or not you're in future films in any capacity, do you know that? Is that something that you were told?
It is. I mean, obviously, you discuss the character that you're playing, but you also want to keep a sense of mystery about a character like that. You know, you want people to have exactly that reaction. You want people to. I mean, that's part of what's so incredible about Star Wars, is that open-ended universe. Is the yearning to understand characters and get to know them. So, but I think certainly Snoke, there is a mystery around him, which is good. So this year we'll see finally the release of Mowgli, which has been in the works for some time. So I'm very, very pleased about that. We're literally finishing in a couple of months. We'll start to trailer it. We'll start to get it on the runway to take it out there. And I'm very interested to see what the public make of it. It is a much darker telling of the tale. It's closer to the tone of Rudyard Kipling's book. And it's a PG-13 movie. So I think it'll smash people's preconceptions about what the Jungle Book is, especially for those people who don't know the book, who have just been brought up with the 1968 animation, or indeed Jon Favreau's recent movie.